Hello and welcome to ISPP Policy Review. My name is Sagrika and I'm the PR editor of the Policy Review. With me, the guest today is Mr. Daljeet Mirchandani. Mr. Mirchandani is a graduate engineer from Birla Institute of Technology. Beginning his career in 1971 as graduate trainee engineer, he retired as the chairman and managing director of Ingersoll Rand India in 2008. Driven by the need for systemic change for learning equity and excellence in K-10, he started Gyan Prakash Foundation in 2012. Through a collaborative model of working with the government education system at the state level and with NGOs in India and the US, the foundation has been able to bring changes to the classroom processes that build a child's curiosity and ability to explore, discover, collaborate, and innovate, which is called navigated learning. Plans are in place to scale the concept through a portal in the state of Maharashtra and other states in India. Mr. Mirchandani continues his association with the corporate world and serves on the advisory board of various companies. So thank you so much, sir, for joining us today on the podcast.
Thank you very much for inviting me.
So, sir, I found the concept of navigated learning very interesting, which is why I would like to start with the concept of what do you think education is and the end goal of education?
So if you look at, all of us are born with our ability to learn, okay? So education fundamentally means it's creating an ecosystem around the individual to fundamentally develop these capabilities in every child, okay? That's what really I simplify education as. So the ecosystem is very important. What do I mean by the ecosystem is the community, the parents, the teacher, elements of the state government education system. This is the ecosystem I call about. This ecosystem is very, very critical for building the capability. And this is what I summarize as education. Now, if you look at what is the end goal of education? I think education is a human right, okay? A lot written about it. And it is extremely necessary that certain grassroots level systemic changes take place in order to make sure that irrespective of the learner's ability, irrespective of the language of communication of the learner, or irrespective of the learner's access to technology, okay, he has the right to achieve the assured learning outcomes that are fundamental for him to make a life of employability. So this is one part of what I call as the end goal. The second goal, which I would enunciate, is that elections in India, in different states, are actually won or lost on the platform of education. This is how important it is. If you look at the Aam Aadmi's success, it was based on education. And I think there is a noise bite of states trying to emulate it. And I wish this accelerates much faster. So these are the two end goals I would put on the table where education is concerned.
All right, so that sounds very interesting, which brings me to the next point of the new education policy. I'm sure you must have expected a question from us on that. So it is supposed to be implemented this year. And do you see that happening, especially in the light of what happened in COVID? And what are the key benefits and some challenges that you see in the policy?
So let me first talk about the benefits, okay, what this policy. Many such NEPs have been done in the past. But what are the, I would say, I see four fundamental changes that we see in this NEP of 2020. The first one is, it specifically talks about moving away from rote-based learning to competency-based learning. That means how do you develop competencies in children, of which rote is one element of it. But you cannot judge a child purely based on recall. You've got to look at the development of competencies in different subjects and also in certain soft skills, etc., to make the holistic development in a child, okay? So this is point number one, moving away from rote to competency-based. Second is, assessments drive behaviors, okay? So when you look at assessments at the end of the year, beginning of the year, you're looking at two, say, maybe endpoints or a midpoint. In a formative assessment, which is what the new education policy talks about, is fundamentally what we call as a continuous assessment. That means you are continuously assessing how a child or a group of children are actually moving forward. So formative assessment is a very big shift in this policy. Third thing, which is being debated a lot, that primary education, which is very critical for the foundation, that the local language as a medium of instruction has now been stated very forthrightly, okay? That children must learn in the local language because that's the language which surrounds them in the entire environment, day in and day out. And fourth important point is integrating early child education into the RTE, which is class 1 to 12. So it's become an integral part. That's what they call the 5+3+3+5 model. Earlier, this early child education, which is very critical for children to be ready to enter class 1, okay, was lying separate under the CDS program. Okay. Now it's an integral part. And I think this change is very, very, it was being talked about, but has been brought into play. These are four very significant shifts that I see in the new education policy. Now, coming to the challenges, I would say that learning is very complex, okay? And as I mentioned earlier, it involves a whole ecosystem coming into play, okay, around the child. And therefore, you cannot walk in with some predetermined solutions, okay? Every region, every culture is very diverse. So we have to move away from predetermined solutions, which is what we practice today, to what I call solutions that should evolve based on the child and the ecosystem. This is a very significant shift, and how quickly can we shift from predetermined to evolving solutions on the ground near the child with the ecosystem is what I see as a first big challenge. Second thing is that I see that the document is very well meaning. Like many policy documents are very well meaning, okay? And the spirit behind it is understood. But the question is, it being a concurrent subject of the center and state, how are you going to actually execute it and see that it percolates right to the grassroots level where change has to take place? These are the two challenges I see going forward for implementing the NEP.
All right. And so since the budgets come out, there's a little bit that we would like to know in that respect, in the sense that how do you think the government can now support children and nonprofits working in the sector? And do you see the budget addressing the issues that the sector faces?
You see, if you look at it, I wouldn't say that the budget allocations, okay, are going to be seeing the success of the policy being implemented. I think the system exists and it's not paucity of funds. But to your other point, that what can the government do to actually work with NGOs? You know, I'm not saying the state governments don't work, because NGOs have some of the best brains to actually innovate this type of solutions that are required to make the NEP come alive. Okay. However, the government having the trust in the NGOs to evolve such solutions, and then the government being the carrier of change. NGOs cannot build capacity, okay? NGOs can fundamentally evolve a solution, work with the government, get the people aligned in the government system to understand and accept it, and then the government is the driver of change. Now, we found that in certain states, like in Maharashtra, in Chhattisgarh, in UP, et cetera, parts of it, we find this happening. But I would say that today, if this is really institutionalized and the state governments work with NGOs in this spirit of evolving solutions on the ground and government being the multiplier, I think big change can take place. This is very, very important. Although today, if you look at it, you see it being done in patches. Okay, in some states don't do it. But I think this is one factor which I see as a partnership between NGO and the government. fundamentally to introduce and to make sure this NEP policy gets traction.
So, so speaking of collaboration, I noticed that Gyan Prakash Foundation works with Panchayati Raj institutions in education. So how do you think communities aid the process of learning, and how do they contribute to the entire journey?
You know, I'll give you a very simple, if you go to a village, I always say that there is a temple in a village and there's a school in the village, right? Everybody can see that. You see the ownership of the community towards the temple, okay? And you see the ownership of the community with respect to the school, right? Let the school be dilapidated and you'll find many communities ignoring it because they say that's the prerogative of the government. I think the change we've been able to bring about, and not only Gyan Prakash, but many NGOs are working at the Gram Panchayat level, and they have an education Gram Sabha, to basically bring into light that the foundation of children takes place in the community itself. And the way you worship and you respect a temple, this is the way you need to respect the education system, which is the school in the village. And I can tell you that it has had phenomenal results. In fact, sometimes you find that schools don't have the budgets to repair the roof, which is leaking. And communities I've seen bringing in money, their own masons coming and doing up the school. But this means that you need to make the community inclusive. NGOs play a very, very significant role in doing that. Making the communities take ownership of the school like you take ownership of the temple. Okay, so this is where I see that working at the grassroots level with the education Gram Sabhas, the Gram Panchayats, the school management committees, is a very, very powerful way to bring the change in. And this is what Gyan Prakash certainly focuses on, along with many other NGOs who follow a similar practice for many years.
All right, sir. And so speaking of community and their involvement, I also noticed that the foundation works on building institutional memory, which is something that is an important aspect of bringing any sort of a sustainable change, right? So how did you decide to do that, and how has that process been for you?
See, in the beginning when we started, we attempted to bring a parallel system to the government, okay? That means you are trying to do something outside the government system, a parallel education system. And suddenly we realized that that's flawed. It cannot work. Even like in power generation, if you generate power, you have to become an integral power of the power grid. Okay. So similarly in education, whatever work you do, you need to integrate with the education system, which means you need to understand the education system, how it works. What is the unit of change in the education system that can have a multiplier effect? What are the platforms of change in the education system that can bring teachers together to discuss learning outcomes in children based on data? This is called institutional process. So if you look at GPF, our whole focus has been to fundamentally work with the government institutions to look at what they are and actually make them perform to potential. Okay, so this is what I call institutionalizing it, because once you do that, the chances are this will sustain. If you do it as an interim intervention, a walkout, it's like a spring, it'll recoil back. So our whole focus has been to work with the government system and institutionalize the process through that.
Okay, sir. And so coming to the concept of data, data has become a buzzword in policy circles. Even we have been working on data-driven governance and decision-making. So how do you think, or do you think that data weighs in policy decisions in India? And if yes, why? And if not, why do you think those are the reasons?
See, let's start at the fundamentals, okay? At a classroom, data from the classroom, which is important because all we are working for is the children learning outcomes, right? So when you look at data of children, data drives change. Now, what we found about 8-9 years ago, when we started this, that teachers did not have data about where the children stood with respect to competencies. Okay, you do an assessment at the beginning of the year, you do an assessment at the end of the year. But are they getting real-time data on a continuous movement of the child on different competencies? Now, when we instituted this data at a grassroots level with the classroom and the teachers saw this data, we didn't have to tell them anything about what to do because they knew what to do. But what was missing was data. So let's start fundamentally with that, okay? So data in the hands of teacher about how children are performing is very, very powerful for fundamental change. Then you can take this data and take it at different levels of the architecture in a government system, whereby the government system then knows that from a data standpoint, where do the children stand on one side? And also very important is the data telling you how capable is the ecosystem around the child. For example, data of a school management committee. How effective is a school management committee? How effective is a teacher? How effective is a Shikshan Parishad, which is a teacher collective? How effective is a Kendra Pramukh who has a direct correlation of learning in a cluster? This data actually going to the district level and the state level gives you a very clear picture on the capability of the ecosystem around the child and data as to how the child is progressing by competency on a continuous assessment basis. So data is extremely critical. Important point is that how do you collect real-time data? Okay, and you need platforms for that. So it is very, very critical, as you correctly mentioned, that today data plays a very significant role. And from this data, you come up to policy changes and corrections and interventions. But let it be all data driven. It's not a policy based on some thinking and imagination. Let policies arrive out of data. Now, if you look at all these changes that have been made in the NAP, these are very well meaning. But fundamentally, will data drive it? And I think this is the key element that we must look at. So you raised a very good point about data.
Yes, sir. And then coming to COVID-19 and its impact on education, since you work with government schools through the foundation, how do you think it has impacted especially the education sector, and what do you think was the biggest challenge that the sector faces because of COVID-19?
So I would say the jury is still out, that children who have not been to school for about 1 year now, March, the whole of this academic year, and is there a regression in the learning levels of children? Okay, some believe no, children learn anyway. So I think the jury is out. Let's not spend too much time on that. Nobody is going to be able to put a correct finger on it. However, I think logically, there would be some regression. To what extent? Depends on child by child learning capability. And I would say this regression will be there because our whole model is based on rote learning, on recall. When I get a concept right, even after 1 year, you ask me about a concept, I can't forget a concept. But I've learned when Aurangzeb was born, after 1 year, I can forget the date. Right? So unfortunately, because of this aspect of rote-based learning, okay, the regression could be much higher. This is the effect, I would say, of COVID. Okay. Now, when you come to the current academic year, let's assume schools are opening now and all state schools are opening. When a child enters a new class, okay, here is a teacher who is not aware of where the child is in terms of its competencies. What has eroded over the last 1 year? You have no idea. So a teacher in class 6, for example, okay, a child comes into class 6, will open the textbook of class 6. and continue to deliver what is she supposed to deliver in class six, not knowing exactly where the learner is with respect to class five. So this big challenge of not being aware where the child is in terms of learning levels against certain competencies is a big challenge I see when the new academic year starts. What teachers are going to do, what practices they will evolve in order to understand where the baseline is, I'm sure teachers will find answers. But are there some technology platforms that can help you understand the baseline? Okay, is a big crying need. And I think if that data is available to children as to where the individual child in a classroom of 30, 40 are there, there's a very good chance that the teachers will be able to navigate them much better. And this is going to be very important. Otherwise, I think the consequences of school dropout, loss in learning, attitude to learning can have a detrimental effect going forward. So this is what I see. And more important, I would say that the challenge you have is that teachers today, if you look by and large, are used to mass teaching. Okay, in a classroom of 30, you're delivering a particular concept, you're moving forward. I think COVID is telling us that you have to move to individualized learning. This is a very big mindset shift in teachers, because every child would have a regression of a different type if they've had a regression. And therefore, individualized learning is going to be a very, very key aspect from a standpoint of a mindset in terms of a teacher to be able to navigate a child post this COVID situation.
So, sir, since we're talking about individualized learning, one way of doing it is by digitalizing the entire education system. And that's been a transition that is in place, which has been accelerated through COVID, I feel. So how do you think digitalization will impact learning outcomes? And secondly, do you think we can bridge the digital and gender divide that exists, especially in government schools, as we know? And what are some ways that we can bridge that gap probably?
See, this whole digitalization of education, I think there are many ways people look at it. For example, people believe that converting a textbook to a digital content, okay, just converting a textbook, does it change learning process? It may make that textbook very interesting in a digital form for a child, but does it involve learning? And I think it's very, very clear, just converting a content to digital format does not impact learning. Downloading YouTubes on a child, okay, on a concept, does it mean learning? Learning means to know that the child has learned, you need to assess. So the loop must be complete. After you teach a concept, an assessment is important to see whether the child has gained the competency. Today, the system is not complete and the loop is not complete, okay? So that's really the biggest challenge which I would see, okay? There are a lot of learning management systems today, okay, which are focused on this individualized learning, okay? However, again, back to my point, can digitalization locate the learner accurately? Which otherwise through some other assessment, you can know where the child is. But can the digital platforms be available where you can actually locate the learner, like you locate a learner on a Google, like you locate a person traveling on a Google map by the long and lat. Okay, and then you mark in the destination, Google map takes you to the destination. Right, simple. Very simple to use and assured outcomes. These platforms are very critical today for individualized learning. So if Daljeet is on a learning curve, okay, I must know where I am today. So digital content becomes very, very apt and it is contextual if I know where I am, and then I use the digital content to navigate myself to my destination. Okay. Now coming to gender divide, let's understand that I'm talking more of rural areas, okay, where we work and where the mass of population underprivileged children are there. See, smartphone penetrations with respect to parents is hardly about 20-27%. That's some data that is moving around. Teachers have smartphones, 90% penetration. Okay, but children's penetration is 27%. Now, if in a COVID period, you have a situation where the teacher has a smartphone, child does not have a smartphone, and you have a good e-learning management system, you can understand what the consequences are and what the penetration can be. And invariably, what we found today, when you come to the gender divide, and one smartphone is available in a family, the family leans toward giving that smartphone to the boy. However, it's very interesting, I must tell you, that if a parent understands the power of the learning management system, where the parent is able to see that the child is learning through an assessment platform, okay, which I call, maybe let's talk about it as the learning navigator. You have a situation where the parent understands it, is prepared to divide the time of his smartphone for what he uses, for what his daughter may use, and for what his son may use. And we've got many examples of that happening. But this requires the education of the parent. So although the penetration is low, but educating the parent can help remove the gender divide, which exists today with the limited penetration.
So, sir, I remember looking at the foundation's work and seeing parents as early child educators. There's this whole program that you've devised. So do you think that program can be scaled up, and what are the benefits that you see of the program?
Very interesting question. As you know, that early child education is a very important aspect of her learning. And as I mentioned, education is about how an ecosystem brings out the capabilities which we are all born with. Now, if you look at early child education from the time a child is born till the age of 3, and 3 to 6 before it goes into class 1, this period of 3 to 5, if you look at 3 to 6, in the COVID period, who's been closest to the child? It's the parent. Okay, Anganwadis are closed. Schools are closed, KG classes are closed. At age of 3 to 5, you cannot put them on Zoom classes. People are attempting it, but I think it's a very, very poor substitute. Now, if you look at a parent, okay, we experimented with this idea in Gyan Prakash Foundation. And not that we did it, many NGOs are working on this, parents as teachers. And I would say that in the slums of Pune, I took about 200 parents and actually first and foremost worked on the mindset change in the parents. And the biggest mindset change when we did our survey was that parents were saying, we cannot teach our children because we are illiterate. Now, this is the mindset with which the parent is sitting. You may give the parent any tool, any digital platform, but this mindset means she was not going to take it forward. Our first effort was that, look, you're not illiterate. Just because you've not passed class 10 doesn't mean you're literate. Okay? There are fundamental things that children need to learn at 3 to 5, and you have the wherewithal to do it. I would say we saw a very, very significant shift in the mindset of the parents. In fact, in the interviews with parents, parents had tears in their eyes to say, you made us a different human being with respect to our children. Earlier, when the children were sitting at home, okay, we used to consider them as a burden. We used to tell them, go out and play. You're bothering me. Today, we invite them because there's so much to learn in the kitchen. And when you go for vegetable shopping, okay, there's so much to learn. And parents have made a substantive shift in actually engaging their children during their cooking period, during the time they go out for shopping to buy vegetables. You learn colors, you learn alphabets. And we've come up with a whole program that what today the competencies children require to actually be qualifying for standard 1, parents can teach. We made a very, very good program. Right now, we're putting it on a platform, technology platform, with a parent app. So, and we're calling this as parents as early teachers. We're calling them as early teachers. They don't substitute a full teacher, but adequate enough that in the COVID period or even post-COVID period, they're able to bring this change into the child. And if you ask me today, if an Anganwadi is working or not working, it's irrespective of that. The parent is in continuous contact, connect, and emotional connect with the child. There's no better connect between the mother and the child. And if a mother is able to give this time while she's working to be able to educate the child, it's a huge impact can be created. So we're trying to bring in this as a movement with many other NGOs and building curriculum, et cetera, et cetera. But I see this as a very game-changing action. It's going to take time, but I'm very, very convinced that this is very critical and very important for early child education if you want to see the foundation in children grow.
Yes, I was actually very intrigued by the whole process, and the video also made me really think about how parents could, contribute to the education.
You saw the video?
Yes, I did. I went to the website and I did check out the video. So I thought that was a very interesting concept. And since we're focusing even in the national education policy on how early childhood programs can be rolled out, I thought that was a great way of doing it. So this is about it. Thank you so much for spending time.